All right, great. I've been California for the last almost 4 years, and before that was in Charleston, South Carolina. I actually trained with Mark George, who is the inventor of the original TMS technology. So came up with this idea in the mid-90s that one could stimulate focally in the brain and produce an effect within a circumscribed circuit. So, as all revolutionary scientific ideas go, you're either thought to be crazy or right. And so he was kicked out of a bunch of scientific meetings, and eventually science prevailed. And so I'm going to talk to you a little bit about an intravenous drug that's being used in clinics around town called ketamine, a new rapid-acting TMS approach, and a way to use TMS to actually modulate a psychotherapeutic technique. So, just as a broad conceptual base, all neuropsychiatric conditions are conditions of neural networks. Brain circuits, similar to the circuits that are in your computer, in your watch, our brains are organized in the same ways. Each component of the circuit has a role to play in experiencing motion and moving, and together in a dynamic circuit, a given brain function occurs when a circuit goes not functioning as properly, and in the motor system we call it a movement disorder, in the psychiatric, in the limbic or cognitive symptoms we call that a psychiatric condition, neurocognitive condition. And so these conditions are actually really similar. Tourette's syndrome is really similar to bipolar disorder, much more similar than stroke is to Tourette's syndrome, but we call these things neurological conditions and we call these things psychiatric conditions, probably at a fault. So just to give you kind of a sense of some of the work that we've been doing, I've been involved in deep brain stimulation surgeries for obsessive compulsive disorder, and what we found, we don't have volume here. Maybe you can't hear that, but you can definitely see it. So this is a gentleman with very severe obsessive compulsive disorder, getting brain surgery, getting a lead implanted into his nucleus accumbens, which is the area that's involved with pleasure. And he had an obsession about toothbrush being contaminated. So this is somebody who throws toothbrush away every day because he thought it was contaminated. I gave him a sterile toothbrush. This is me here. Gave him a sterile toothbrush. The brain was totally silent, so I put on sterile gloves, unpacked the toothbrush, gave it to him, nothing happened. Then I contaminated this toothbrush. I was on the non-sterile side in the OR, so it's not a risk to him. And lo and behold, you see this activity. What you are actually seeing there, if you hear it, what you're hearing there, is an obsession. The neurophysiologic basis of an obsession experienced in the nucleus of. So another way to think about this, or a way to flip it on its head, is to say that the things that we diagnose as being behaviors are actually just end products of these neurophysiological abnormalities. So if I had him, like I said, I had him hold this sterile toothbrush and the brain was totally silent, right? Is that everybody capture that? So that's the idea, is that just like a neurological condition, where you can have a recording and have an abnormality that you can capture, one can have the same sort of thing with a psychiatric condition. You can also induce emotion with brain stimulation. So this is a lady who is getting her brain stimulated to experience mirth. I feel happy. So the idea here is that they're inducing an emotional experience. If you see her before and after, she actually isn't very happy. And so the idea here is that emotion is generated internally. Emotion can be turned on and off by turning brain regions on and off. And that's another kind of central idea of all of this. And so what is this kind of idea of interventional psychiatry? The idea is that that we can zoom in a brain region, in a brain circuit, and we can change the activity of that circuit. We can stimulate, maybe the gentleman with firing, if we stimulate it long enough, and as it comes, you would see that abnormal firing in his brain and normalize the circuit. Right? So, a lot of people ask me why treatment-resistant depression? Why didn't I go down the neurology route and do something like Parkinson's? Why am I interested in some other major psychiatric conditions? Schizophrenia, I'm interested in all those things, but why depression? The reason why is, for me, is that this is comorbid with everything, right? You can have obsessive-compulsive disorder and have depression. Schizophrenia and have depression, Parkinson's disease and have depression. And so if you can understand what depression is, you can actually help a whole lot of people. If you read the Parkinson's literature, the most disabling symptom of Parkinson's, not the motor abnormalities, depression. It's also it's the newest risk factor in the American Heart Association's risk factors for developing coronary artery disease. Ability to get heart attacks. So it used to be diabetes, hypertension, hyperlipidemia. Now depression is number four. And so what if that, and if you have a heart attack, you're more likely to get depression. So what if that cycle or that kind of circuit down from the brain to the heart that we know exists is bidirectional in some way? It's an interesting thought. So depression is an abnormality of functional networks in the brain. So the idea is that in optimal brain health, the person is able to be completely fluid, right? You're not attaching to any ideas in any kind of strong way. You're not stuck in a certain way of thinking. You can have a new piece of information come to you and you can be able to deal with it in a flexible way. Mental flexibility, that's what we call it. So depression is the opposite of that. It's hyperconnectivity in certain brain regions that produces an inability to transition out of brain networks. So people get stuck in certain brain networks. If you ask them about treatment-resistant depression, they'll agree with that statement. They'll say, yeah, I'm very stuck on thinking about certain things. I think about it a lot. I really want to think about them, but I can't stop. Things like this. And what's interesting is the more severe you are, the longer duration, let's say, of depression, the more connectivity. Right? Anybody ever made the foolish choice of driving on the beach with their car? I have. You can tell. So when you drive on the beach with your car, if you get stuck, the thing that you should not do, I've done, not to, is you should not spin your wheels out. Why? Because your car's in safety. That's what happens in depression. You get stuck in the spinning, and the wheels get deeper and deeper. The connectivity gets more and more. So how do we deal with this problem? Disorganized way, based off of physicians' kind of general subjective sense of it. So we have a pretty organized way of dealing with depression. It's called STAR-D, and people use some variation of STAR-D. It's an algorithm, right? So takes Alexa, Lexapro, whatever. Wait a certain amount of time. If you're not better, then do therapy. If you haven't done that, then you do another medication. And you kind of get down through that whole algorithm. And you get to a certain point, and that algorithm hasn't worked for you. What do you do, right? Some people get TMS first. That would be my thinking, but some people just go straight to ECT. Some people go to ECT because they end up in the hospital and they can't get ketamine or TMS. You can't get TMS in the hospital, you pretty much can't get ketamine in the hospital, right? So but there's no real rhyme or reason beyond access for that. Okay. And so part of my goal is to actually make this logical, stepwise, and predictive, right? If we can have a brain stimulation technology that if it worked, it would tell you something about what's going on. And if it didn't work, it would actually also tell you something about what's going on. That would be incredibly useful. Or if it worked, but then it didn't work for very long, but it worked completely when it worked, that would also tell you something about what's going on, and would help you to make more decisions as you go further down the chain. And so some of the senior colleagues at Stanford published this article in which they said, had kind of a two-group argument. Well, the first group was to say, what we need to really do is learn how ketamine works. Because this is supposed to be one of the most important antidepressant discoveries in the last 30 years. If we just learn how ketamine works, maybe we could treat this problem. So that's one group. The other one says, if we learn how circuits work, we could deal with this problem. And so I'll be presenting data to you to say, we figured out this one, and we're on the way to figuring out this one. So, this idea of therapies first, we think that the mechanism of ketamine can be deconstructed by blocking certain actions of ketamine. So if I think a drug works at site A and site B, and I co-administer another drug that blocks site A, and it still works, what would that tell you? It's working at site B. If I give a drug that works at site A and site B, and it's blocked site A, and it doesn't work anymore, what would that tell you? It's site A. If you block at completion, it's completely site A. Or if you block the majority of it, you're blocking most of site A. And yeah, the other idea is we can use things like optogenetics and tell us something about brain circuits, and then we can build better brain circuit therapies. So this is Tom Insel, who I guess lives in California now, who's quoted as saying, who's an NIH director, that this is the most important breakthrough in 30 years or so. So the idea, and I'll get into this highly, highly technical thing, the idea essentially is that you're increasing stress-based excitatory transmission in the brain. So the brain gets stressed, it dumps all of these excitatory chemicals in the brain, and there's a problem that happens after that. Ketamine goes in and fixes that problem. That's the kind of story, right? The issue is that ketamine is a super dirty drug. It works like all these, I'm going to read these to you, all these places, and we don't know which one is actually driving the antidepressant effect. And what's really interesting is that ketamine actually interacts with the opiate system, right? So ketamine works on opiate receptors and treats pain in a similar way to the way opiates treat pain. And these studies were done in the 70s and 80s and things like this. And I go through this. Naltrexone, so this little example I gave you earlier of A and B, and you have a blocker for A, right? Naltrexone is the blocker for A. So naltrexone blocks the opiate receptor. So if ketamine doesn't work by affecting the opiate system, then it should still produce an antidepressant effect, right? If it works through the opiate system and you block the opiate system, you should block the antidepressant effect. Simple as that. So we give naltrexone one day when people get ketamine, we give placebo one day when people get ketamine, and they get ketamine twice. Then if the opiate system isn't involved, how many times do you guys think the ketamine would work?
Once.
Twice. If it doesn't have a role, it would be twice. If it works through the opiate system, how many times do you think it would work?
Once.
One time. And so that's the main idea. We're blocking the opiate receptor, so ketamine can't get there. And so we took a bunch of folks with depression, we randomized them to two infusions, they had to be pretty severe. We gave them naltrexone, we gave them placebo before, and this is, you guys do this? And that's what we saw. It doesn't take a medical degree to tell me that these lines look different to you, right? So if you take the average of everybody that got ketamine plus placebo, this is what they got. 7 days of really good mood. If you look at that same group when we gave them the opiate blocker, they only got 20% of that. So, in summary, ketamine is working as an opiate. What does that mean in the context of the opiate crisis that we have going on? It's a big open question, right? And this is a tricky problem, and this is, if you're like one of the, like the first groups to see this data, right? This is a tricky problem. You have this sitting at the American Journal right now. And so, what do we do with this? Do we keep doing this? Do we not? It's a big question. We did it in a mouse. We saw the same thing. You can block the antidepressant effect you see here with naltrexone. It's not just a human thing, cross species. So opiates are responsible for most of the antidepressant effects in ketamine. Okay. You guys, any questions about that part? Yes?
Is ketamine addictive?
Ketamine is addictive. That is a great question. Ketamine, there's a major ketamine addiction problem in Asia. And a fair amount of people get addicted to ketamine. So it's a big, yes?
If it works as an opiate, then does that mean other opiates work for depression?
Great question. The answer is yes. So buprenorphine, which is a partial agonist of the mu opioid receptor, is also antidepressant. It seems to be special in the sense that if you give morphine over and over again to people, some people get it's depressogenic for them. Yeah. So some of the other opiates are depressogenic, but buprenorphine seems to be antidepressant. It seems to work for a while. But it poses a bigger question, which you may or may not be thinking already. What is depression? Why would depression respond to opiates? You know, that sort of thing. And it's a question of what is it fundamentally, what is depression? What's interesting is that TMS, which I'll talk about now, actually releases opiates into the brain too. So if you put pain, what they call capsaicin pain or experimental pain, and you do TMS, you can actually block the pain, create an antinociceptive effect or block the pain with TMS. If you give the same sort of drug, an opiate blocker, you can block that. So so it tells us something more about what depression is. Okay.
Are they all addicted?
What's that?
It seems like they're almost all addicted.
To the drugs?
Well, ketamine.
Ketamine. TMS, which we'll talk about in a second. Brainstem intervention. The ketamine is addictive, has been shown to be addictive in Asia. There's people, cases of people being having ketamine addiction in the United States for sure. There aren't a ton of people that have gotten ketamine for depression, in which there's evidence that they've subsequently become addicted to ketamine. But there are a few cases of that, so it's a big question. You know, one of the things that is complex is that right now people have to go and get an infusion from a doctor, and so it's harder to be addicted to something which you don't have access to unless the doctor gives it to you. But, you know, it's an open question. I'll take two more questions, and I'll keep rolling, and then we'll take more questions at the end. Does that work? Yes, ma'am.
I was wondering about, you know, if it's addictive, then how can it be used therapeutically?
It's a great question. Yes, so that's what we're going to wrestle with after this paper comes out.
I'm sorry, could you repeat the question?
Yeah, absolutely.
For the audience?
What's your name? What Christy was saying was how can you justify giving it if it's addictive? There are lots of things that we give that that are addictive potentially. You know, I mean, I think that a lot of people are scratching their head about how we got into this situation with the opioid crisis that we're in now, and how we can mitigate this going forward. And it's because we've been giving people addictive drugs, you know, for pain. So opiates are addictive. Yeah, people can get addicted to a lot of things. People get addicted to benzodiazepines, which are regularly given in psychiatric scenarios. So I don't think it's inherently problematic necessarily for a drug to be addictive, but one needs to study it a lot more if it is addictive so that you can mitigate those risks. So, you know, for me, the kind of final question at the end of the day is my patient going to kill himself? Right? And that's the one that I'm wrestling with the most, right? Is my patient going to kill himself in the day? Because that's the kind of the finality of all this. And so there are people who, have been quite suicidal who've gotten a lot of good out of ketamine, right? And maybe they would have killed themselves had they not had the ketamine. So that's one argument. The other argument, kind of a counter argument, which, you know, I hear both of these, is how can we roll this out at such a serious level? We don't know, we didn't know until now how this was really working. You know, and I think that's a valid argument too. So we're gonna really wrestle with these questions. I'm gonna get his question and then I'll come back at the end. Yes, sir, in the back. Oh, you can propofol. Yeah, both anesthetic drugs. Yeah, it's a great question. Yeah, propofol, it's a little bit, actually, like, propofol is a little bit of an unusual drug to be using in that way. And so, I don't think he was doing any ketamine, but it gets into this bigger thing. There are actually several, you know, famous people who had ketamine problems in the past. And it's, you know, it is not a straightforward thing, for sure. All right, so I'm going to keep rolling with this, and then I'll get some more questions in. Okay, so that was the first move. So can we understand what ketamine is? Can we understand? So I would say that we are much closer to that after, you know, hopefully that was a convincing story for you for that part. And then the second one is, how can we use neuroscience to build interventions that are robust and can help people and don't have these same questions. You know, I never want to be in an audience and people asking me the question of, is my brain stimulation treatment addictive, and what sorts of negative consequences are going to come from that. So I don't think that I'm going to be in that boat, hopefully. And so we've known for a long time since the mid-90s that you can use TMS as a treatment for depression. And since 2008, 2009, we've had solid evidence to show that this is a treatment for depression. So we know that this is an effective treatment for depression, can be applied once a day, every day, for 6 weeks, 5 minutes a week for 6 weeks, and a certain percentage of people get better. So about a third of people remit completely, lose all symptoms for a while. About 50% have what we call a response, or a 50% reduction in symptoms. But that's not everybody, and it takes a long time. It takes 1.5 months. And as some of you are probably very aware, you can go from having a job to not having a job because of depression in 6 weeks. And you can go from having a home to becoming homeless. And a lot of things can happen in 6 weeks, right? So the question, the way that TMS was designed before, it was designed under the knowledge that we had in 1995. And since then, the technology has evolved and our understanding of brain science has evolved over time. And so one of the reasons why TMS wasn't done more than once a day and wasn't done in an aggressive way is because the machines couldn't handle it. And because the concern was that it would cause a cognitive side effect, like an ECT. Since then, we've learned that, if anything, TMS is pro-cognitive, improves working memory, and things like this. And you can do it multiple times a day, and you can actually And I see improvements from doing it a lot in the day. So I'll talk about that in a second. But the idea essentially is a simple one. If I use the thumb as a surrogate of how brain works, and I stimulate over the area that controls the thumb, right, I can make the movement of the thumb much greater after stimulating it. Does this make sense? So what that means is that I can actually visibly see that I'm turning a brain region up or turning a brain region down. And I can use that information to place the coil in a different area, place the coil in a mood regulatory area, and know that same exact approach is going to turn up the brain regions that are involved in telling your brain you are in control. Right? So what do people tell me about depression that's so bad is that they feel like all these things are happening and they have no control over it. Where in reality, some of it is happening, you don't have control. Some of it is happening to all of us and we don't have control of it all the time. And so it's a lot about what you perceive, what your perceived control is. And so the idea of TMS is to turn up perceived control, to actually turn up the brain regions that are involved with feeling like you're in control. Right? So this first case, a mentor back in Charleston, a lady that was at the NIH for I think a decade, you know, her brain was very hypometabolic. They did this TMS approach, and then over time, her depression scores significantly reduced. This is the general schedule, right? So the 6 weeks, you come in Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. You're in for about an hour. There was a recent study that showed that if you do 3 minutes of something called data burst, once a day, every day for 6 weeks, it's equivalent, it's the same as doing 40 minutes of traditional TMS. What that means is in 3 minutes, you can do the job that you had to do in 40 minutes. What's useful about that is you can do a bunch of stuff, you can do a bunch of treatments in a day if a treatment only lasts 3 minutes. Or you can do, three treatments in a row for 10 minutes, give the person a break, and then do it again. And you can do an entire 6 week course of TMS in a day, which is what we're doing. We're giving people a 6 week course worth of TMS in a single day. Or rather, we're giving, and this is what we're giving 5 days, so we're giving 7.5 months worth of TMS in 5 days. And we see that people are well in a couple of days. What does that mean? It means that you can actually treat somebody in the hospital. Right? So, yeah. So the idea here, and just focus on this one, the idea is learning theory, right? So the idea is, anybody ever tried to cram for a test? How'd you do it?
Late night.
Anybody ever tried to cram for test one and then take test two after they studied and then took a break and studied and then took a break?
Yeah, it helps.
Which one of those did you learn the material longer?
The second one,
exactly. Why? We actually know why this works. It's called spaced learning. So the idea is that if you stimulate a brain region, you can enlarge some of these little areas that connect the brain together, dendritic spines, and you can prime some, right? And if you wait about an hour and you do it again, you can enlarge the one that you primed. But if you cram all night, you don't. Right? So you need to, and that's why you remember the things that you studied over and over again with time in between. And so what we're saying is we're actually going to use an approach to teach the brain it's back in control and take the principles of learning and actually feed that back into the brain so that the brain actually learns in a long-term way, it's not depressed, and it's in control. Does that make sense? So this is the protocol. 5 days. It's 10 hours a day. So people come in, and a lot of people told me, they said, this is way too much. Nobody's going to ever do this. You'll never recruit anybody for this. Nobody's going to stay with you for 10 hours a day. I haven't had any trouble with that. Actually, everybody that's wanted to do it, they've stuck through. I haven't really had anybody quit because they say it's too expensive. And this is actually what is this? This is an inpatient stay, right? This is a 5-day inpatient stay where you walk in depressed and suicidal and hopefully you walk out well. And everybody that I've proposed this to, that I round with the inpatient unit, I say, if I had this device, would you do it? Oh yeah, please. And to the point where the nurses sometimes tell the patients when I'm rounding on the weekend in the hospital that I'm trying to do this, and they come and ask me if they can go ahead and do it. It makes total sense to me. So the patients actually like this. And if you ask a patient, would you rather do 6 weeks or would you rather do 5 days if you had to be here all day, almost all of them tell me, give me the 5 days. I'd rather just be out of the misery quicker. Right? But it is a lot of time. All right. Let me plus through this for you and get to the good stuff. Okay. So if you look at people who are not super treatment resistant. So you look at people who are pretty treatment resistant, some of them disabled, and they responded to, say, ketamine. Many of these people did for 5 or 7 days, and you do this protocol, what do you get? So far, I've gotten in an open label way, we're doing a blinded trial now, 3 to 4 to 8 months, nothing else, no other antidepressants, just whatever they were on before that wasn't working, and it helped. Show you guys a video. So this will give you some. I wish I had the volume.
Essentially saying early learning and reaction. And we do that over and over again. scrubbing on the brain of it, so you can't find it.
After about 4 or 5 days, that's when the results really start to come in.
The first couple of days, I thought, well, it's interesting, but I'm not really noticing anything. And I just started to feel a little better, kind of as if the load on my shoulders was getting lighter and lighter. I felt so alive, and I was doing all these things that I hadn't been able to do for a long time ago. It was just like nirvana. Sort of a magic bullet, and I'm just really excited about getting more treatments.
A lot of the field of psychiatrists are now giving up on the idea that there's a switch that we can throw somewhere in the brain that would have a dramatic improvement. And here we're showing that there might in fact be something that's something like a switch.
I'm really looking forward to a life that is not a good life. I'm really sorry. Becoming the whole person that I am. Doing things that I just put off 3 years.
So, the story goes with Brandon. I was testing this in less severe people, people that I thought meant this may work, having good success, but people that were more moderate to severe depression, maybe some of them on disability, but never had ECT, never had, you know, some of them had some TMS, but never had ECT, never had ketamine or anything like that. Jessica Hawkins, who is Alan Chatsberg's lab manager, came to me and said, I want you to include this guy in your kind of beta testing of the protocol and just see if this helps him. And I said, okay. I thought she knew what the general criteria for the protocol was. And then later on, I sat down with her and said, tell me about this guy. And she said, oh, well, he was on the deep brain stimulation implant wait list right before the trial closed. And I was like, and then she told me he's been depressed for 4 years, failed ECT, which only about 15% of people do, by the way, failed ketamine infusion, failed normal TMS, actually like 100 treatments in the end, so it wasn't like trivial, the NIH for a while. And so so at the end I was like, yeah, you can't be serious, I don't think this is gonna work for this guy. I was wrong. And so I'll never forget it. It was Memorial Day weekend, the weekend before, which meant that if we're going to treat him, I had to agree to come in on Saturday. So it was like Tuesday, if you said her. So I sat him down and I felt like I didn't want to waste his time, I didn't want to waste my time. And I said, look, I don't think that this is going to work for you. You're too severe. I really want to help you, but I don't think this is going to be the way for you. And so I don't think it's going to work either, actually. But I believe in science. And so let's do it. And I said, okay, I believe in science too. And so I didn't want to turn the guy away if he wanted to do it. So I treated him, which was one of the best decisions of my career, actually. Because by Thursday to Friday, he started smiling a lot more, but he still wasn't sure. And by Friday, he looked pretty good. And when he walked in on Saturday, he was completely remitted. He was a Hamilton score of 5. Which most of the folks at Stanford are higher than that. You know, most of them. So and this is an incredibly low, a low score, right? So that was really dramatic. And so I waited to see what happened. It lasted a couple of weeks, and then he relapsed, and I called. Mark, one of my mentors, and I said, what should I do? Oh, I didn't expect this to happen. He said, do it again and see if it happens again. I did it again, and it happened again. And so then I went out and recruited these super severe folks, and when I found this, 5 out of 6 of them had the same exact sort of response, this dramatic improvement. 5 out of 6 people who meet criteria for brain surgery were able to achieve transient but full remission from this approach, which suggests to me that this is actually the right brain region, the wrong dose. Right? And so we've done, and we showed that that there was a whole lot more reduction in the connectivity between these two brain regions after than before. So we showed a biological effect as well. And so the idea in this algorithm I was talking about before is maybe you can take somebody and do something like this. If it's sustained, then you would just keep treating them. So in the case of the folks that got many, many months out of this, we would just use this as a treatment, right? And the people like Brandon, we may use this as a way to probe him for a more permanent device, so an implanted device that would do the same sort of thing every day of his life, keep him not depressed, or never become any of his TMS stimulation, because it would just be running as a cortical stimulator. And if you just didn't have a response, then maybe that's not the right area for you or the right stimulation approach for you. And so I've also been involved in people getting implanted cortical stimulators. And we saw the same sort of thing in time. We saw a reduction in their depression and a sustained improvement in their depression. So the idea here is that we may have a target, we may have a brain region that actually, if given enough stimulation, could treat what we think is this really refractory group of people that otherwise don't have any treatments. Brandon is an orphan in that way, he doesn't have any other treatments to offer. This is the only treatments that ever worked for him. He had an implanted vagus nerve stimulator, and that didn't work for him. And so the bigger idea here is how do we kind of transition this idea into this idea. How do we make the psychiatric, and I'm not suggesting necessarily that the inpatient setting is quite like this anymore, but how do we transition from an idea of a locked unit to an idea of using brain physiology, anatomy, connectivity, stimulation to guide what we're doing with folks, and actually have a finality to it, a decision that we've made about what we're going to do and what this person's problem is. And so 150 years ago, epilepsy was thought to be demon possession or whatever you want to say. And then over time, we've used these tools, and now we really understand it. So somebody has epilepsy and they come in to the hospital. This is actually a picture of an epilepsy unit, right? So they come into the hospital and they get a bunch of tests and figure out what brain region is going wrong. And we do some sort of medication intervention or some sort of surgical intervention or stimulation intervention, and then that person knows exactly what their problem is, what brain region is not working correctly, and then that thing gets fixed and their life keeps going, right? And I would suggest that that's actually a feasible possibility in psychiatric conditions too. So I'll move on to this last kind of pretty far out there idea that seems to be working. This was published after my first article talking about interventional psychiatry, and this was kind of like a funny cartoon response to it. And I looked at this back in 2014, and I said, God, that's kind of offensive. I look at it today, I said, this is the perfect slide. So I kind of emulated this, and I said, there's this phenomenon where people who are highly hypnotizable can do all sorts of things, like quit smoking spontaneously or go under the knife without any anesthesia. And so could we capitalize on this idea? Could we make most of the population hypnotizable through TMS by changing the brain regions responsible for hypnotizability? What that means in kind of a greater scope is, can we use brain stimulation to change the way your brain interacts with a therapist? Prime the brain to be more receptive to therapeutic suggestion. And if we have some preliminary data to suggest that we can. And hypnotizability, by the way, to change hypnotizability is quite hard. It's more stable than IQ in time. It's less stable than handedness, but more stable than IQ. So if you checked your IQ now and in 25 years, you had an IQ test 25 years ago and you checked it now, you checked your hypnotizability 25 years ago, and now the hypnotizability would be more similar than your IQ. So it's really something hard to change. And what it is actually a brain connectivity pattern. So people that are high hypnotizables have a certain high level of connectivity. People that are low hypnotizables have a low level of connectivity. You can use brain stimulation to actually change connectivity and bust through this. And we used a special type of brain stim that was effective across everyone. And we showed that if we mapped out a person's brain, then we stimulated, we targeted and stimulated, and we mapped out again, we can actually change their trait hypnotizability. We can make them more responsive to suggestion and do it for about an hour. About the length of a psychotherapy visit, actually. And so that's the idea. We can actually change the connectivity pattern between these two brain regions and show that we actually changed the brain for that hour, made the brain more suggestible for that hour. All right, so the group. Just take a seat. You guys tell me any more questions about any of this?
Yes, ma'am.
So, is all this actually, I guess, can this be mainstream? It's not now, right?
So TMS is mainstream. Ketamine, seemingly pretty mainstream at the time. Magazine article.
So could it be long-term therapy? Really?
You're talking about which piece?
TMS.
Yeah, I mean, so TMS is already FDA approved for depression. So the 6-week normal treatment you can go to your doctor and get today. It's already an approved intervention for depression. The rapid form is all experimental, but our goal is to get eventually get an approval by the FDA or one of these entities soon, so the next couple of years.
That would be for the 5-day?
For the 5-day deal, yeah.
So
yeah.
Right now that's not available?
Right now it's available through research studies that we're doing. So if you're interested, you can contact Madison and Flyers, and some of you guys can contact me and can screen you for the study. We'll have this on the inpatient unit at Stanford over the next couple of months. So people could, if you ended up needing to be hospitalized for depression, get it there. We have an outpatient study too. So it's relatively accessible for people that live here. It's not really available many other places in the United States yet, just because we developed it on the road or whatever. If you've got an interest and you want to get in touch with us, and you're depressed, we definitely get you set up to be screened. Yes, ma'am.
Kevin, I have a question about depression in bipolar patients.
Yeah, sure.
Is there a chance to be switched over to mania?
Great question.
From depression.
That's a great question. Yeah, with TMS or with ketamine or both?
No, with TMS.
With TMS. Yeah, so there are case reports of people getting switched into mania. There's kind of two scenarios, right? So there's people that aren't actually bipolar that have switch into mania that's clearly stimulation induced. You can stimulate somebody into getting mania that's not bipolar, actually. It doesn't last very long. It lasts a couple of days. You give somebody a little bit of that again, it goes away. There are probably 4 or 5 cases in the literature of hundreds of thousands of people that have been treated, so it's a pretty rare phenomenon. The other one is switching somebody who's bipolar into mania. That's going to be, related to the person's illness. So, for instance, when you get manic, you get floridly manic and all of that. It could be something like that. If somebody's on a mood stabilizer while they're getting TMS, atypical antipsychotic, something like this, the chances of all that happening are a lot lower. So we've treated a ton of people with bipolar depression, maybe a third to a half of our clinic with bipolar depression. I've never seen anybody actually get fully flipped into even hypomania. I've seen somebody kind of get wrapped up for a couple of days, months, and hundreds and hundreds of people. So it's a risk, but it's, I would say that the risk of untreated depression and bipolar depression is a much greater, for somebody having a suicide attempt or completion, over this risk. Yeah, my sense of it.
Just the second question first. In a patient who's OCD,
Yeah.
With the families to apply for,
sure.
What is the switch dose? Is there
Yeah, it's a good question. So OCD is about to be approved, is what I hear. I don't know, I'm not in those meetings, so I don't know exactly when or if, but I've seen the data, it looks pretty good, so OCD would be approval. And that's, so if that gets approved, then it's kind of like depression if you have a family member with bipolar or something like that. I mean, it's possible, but it's not, I don't know, when you do CNS the normal way, you get it once a day and you're getting monitored chronically. So people are checking on you every day. So it's one of these few scenarios in psychiatry where you're gonna see your psychiatrist every day, 5 days a week for 6 weeks. And so if somebody's looking like they're going in that direction, you can pretty much handle it. The only time when that's a problem is, you know, some TMS shop where the doctor's not really around and some tech doing it in the community or something, and they don't see pick up on stuff, and then maybe that's a risk. But I wouldn't be. I'm never really worried about that. Yes, sir.
Do you have any? I recently read an article about TMS being used for addiction.
Yeah.
Do you have any experience or ideas?
Yeah, absolutely. So we're interested in using the same protocol to try to treat addiction with TMS, and I talked to folks in Washington about this possibility. And so it's an interest of ours. The clinical work, I've never run an addiction TMS study myself, just because I'm primarily a depression researcher, although I'm very interested in expanding. When people have an addiction and they have depression, they come onto our service for depression, the side effect sometimes is that maybe their addiction is better, right? We're not treating them for that, but we're treating them for something else that's the same brain region, right? So I've had a couple of interesting experiences. One was a guy who was in a halfway house that just went through detox, or cocaine, opiates, or something. He had Tourette, he had depression. We were treating him for depression and Tourette, and his addiction craving went totally away. So he was actually easily transitioned back to his mom's house, and I, as far as I understand, hasn't really gotten back into the drugs again. Another person was a lady who, and this is an interesting kind of story about how we think about mental illness, right? So a lady who was apparently drinking, kind of started drinking in and around when she first started TMS, really tell us, her therapist and her psychiatrist, and you know, not the brain stimulation folks, but kind of med psychiatrist, found out about this, let me know, and I sat down with them and talked about it. We chose a way to do TMS where there was no, you know, there was basically no seizure risk, so you can do right-sided inhibitory TMS, but there was no seizure risk. And so we gave her that, and when I said to the therapist, I would be surprised if she ends up in AA in a couple of weeks. And the therapist said, I've taken care of her for 10 years, talked to her about AA 20 times, and it's not going to happen. And I said, well, we're changing perceived control. We're changing the way the brain is sensing their own control in the environment. You could be surprised 2 weeks later if she's an AA. So there was a big study in Italy where they gave cocaine-dependent folks even TMS for a bunch of minutes, and about 75% of the people got TMS stopped using cocaine and stayed abstinent for months and months after that. So it was amazing. Okay. Yes.
How long does this last, the treatment? Like, if you do the 5 day,
Yeah, it just depends on how severe the person is. So we've had a couple of 19-year-olds that have come through the protocol that haven't done anything but this, and they're still well, like 8 months and back to college. And like, under all the stress of college and still in relapse. And we've had people like Brandon who only lasted a couple of weeks, but he's like a surgical candidate. So that algorithm that I showed earlier, you've got this idea of sustained remission and you want to treat, and that's pretty much, I mean, the I had to go out and find these people that met the surgical criteria, the super severe people. I couldn't even find them in the Stanford clinic because they were so severe. I had to call and look for folks that were that severe. And so those people don't get very long, couple of weeks. People are pretty severe. People are on disability for depression and failed like 15 meds in the current episode. We have 4 months for some of those people. So it's not, and not doing anything else. And so it's not, I think this has the possibility of taking care of business for a while for most people.
Yeah. And the side effects, other than maybe like switching?
That's a great question. Yeah, so we haven't seen anybody switch. Yeah, knock on wood. We haven't seen any seizures yet, knock on wood. We do extensive cognitive testing on these guys. And that's actually one of the biggest questions, because this is the most TMS pulses ever given in the human brain in a day. So are you causing these people to be cognitively dysfunctional? So in my efforts to find somebody that is like the end of the road, failed ECT, failed normal TMS, failed all these meds. So it was very hard to find these people. I had to kind of relax the exclusion criteria a little bit and take people that had, non-problematic neurological conditions, but ones that, from like a risk standpoint, ones that would normally exclude people from brain surgery for depression. So I took a lady who had Parkinson's disease. People with 6 years of Parkinson's have pretty profound executive deficits, so they're not really able to do certain tasks when a neuropsychologist is stacking a bunch of blocks in a certain way and things like that. And this is pretty standard. So you get 6 years of Parkinson's, nobody's able to do that across the board. After she finished her treatment, she was able to do all of them, like somebody that was age matched. So it was very exciting for us when we're writing that case up with this idea that we could actually take care of business and cognitive deficits as well. Yeah.
What about headaches? Is
that a side effect? I haven't anybody have like a profound headache. People have little minor headaches you get a little bit of stimulation. You feel like this tapping. It's kind of sharp sometimes. That goes away if people habituate to it. And like one person didn't habituate to it for a week or something like that. But the majority of people do fine. Yeah.
Yes, sir. If a patient has been on ECT for a few years, what's the probability of being able to switch over to TMS without any problems?
Normal TMS or this?
This.
It's a good question. I mean, are they responders to TMS? I mean, to ECT?
Negative effects.
Yeah, of course, yeah. So I haven't treated anybody like that yet. The assumption is there would be more, so it should work based on the data that we have, probably. I don't know how long it would last. If they are an ECT responder, conceivably it would last more than a couple of weeks. But all this needs to be done. Like when you, like we're 20 people deep or something, 22 people deep or something like this, but all these iterations, that's why I want to get this on the inpatient unit at Stanford, because we need 200 people.
Right.
And then we can figure this out. When we do 200 people, I'll be able to answer some of these sorts of specific clinical questions. Normal TMS, in meta-analyses, non-psychotic depression is non-inferior to ECT. So switching somebody, and there's a fair amount of literature on that, switching somebody from ECT to normal TMS works. So conceivably this could work same, better, who knows. But yeah, it's early days. So we'll do this 1, 2, 3, 4 from the same user.
So is the TMS machine older than one and the rapid TMS are the same machine?
Yeah, so we're using the same machine that's already been FDA approved. We're just using it in very different ways. We're using different simulation pattern, we're using a different kind of schedule. We're making stimulation very focal and targeted.
Okay. Otherwise, the same machine.
Same machine, yeah. Yes, sir.
Generalized anxiety disorder. I've been reading where there's a variant of TMS that's effective for that.
Right.
A different part of the brain. Have you tried that?
Sure.
Doing TBS and all for GAD.
Yeah, that's a great question. So we haven't, so I look at, so anxiety is always tricky when you have comorbid depressions. You're always trying to figure out, is this anxiety from, you know, the depression? Is this somebody who's got GAD and depression? And so what we've seen is people with anxiety coming in, some of them it resolves completely, others it sticks around and the other stuff gets better. It's just, and it's probably this issue that it's GAD, and I don't think the left-sided stimulation really works for people with GAD. There's a variant, which I think is what you're referring to, where you stimulate inhibitory TMS over the right ALPSC, and there are a couple smaller papers that show you do an aggressive protocol, not like this level of aggressive, but like maybe 20 minutes or something a day of inhibitory TMS over the right, you can actually take care of a lot of the generalized anxiety disorder symptoms. It's never been done at the like multi-site level, so I can only speak to small trials, but people tend to see, you know, feel like this is something that is helpful for GAD, and so we have given people this inhibitory right-sided stimulation too, and they ended up reporting improved anxiety symptoms, so that's like clinical experience. I don't think we'll be targeting GAD in these studies in a super short term, just because there's a lot of work to do just getting this sorted out for TRD, you know, for treatment-resistant depression, but it's a great question. Yes, ma'am?
I'm wondering about the cost of the ITBS treatment.
It's free right now.
Well, not only if you get into your study, but if you're lucky enough to get onto stations Stanford's inpatient unit. So let's say it goes through and it gets approved, and now it's available to everyone. What is the cost? Would Medicare cover it? What if you need to have it currently, like every month?
And
you have to spend 5 days. So how does that work?
All good questions. Yes. Yeah, so. Medicare pays for normal TMS now. It took a while, so they didn't obviously want to do that right at the beginning, but after a while they covered. So Stanford is one of the few TMS providers for Medicare in the Bay Area. It's, you know, you don't have to have a prior auth, you just get it. The deal is that psychiatric admissions are incredibly expensive. Talking about like the finances of medicine, getting somebody paid for a psychiatric admission is in the thousands, and you know, I've seen huge bills, right? And so what I found actually is that the hospital system is very motivated to put this in, and they're very, very motivated to put it in because they have these long length of stays. So you have a long length of stay, and you can't get somebody out of the hospital, and it's extraordinarily expensive. So in the context, doing something like this is not that expensive to do, independent of its own billing code. And then when you have a billing code on top of that, the chances there's going to be a reimbursement, I think, is pretty high. Just because if you do the numbers, which I've done, it's way cheaper to do this than it is to keep somebody in the hospital for a month. It's the reality of the situation. And it's way better. Like, you know, I mean, you just not to the hospital, and maybe you're well, and you get out, or 5 days, and you're out. It's actually reasonable. So I think, like, and this could be, you know, my naivete, I don't know, but I think, from what I can tell, that there's going to be a huge motivation from a cost-saving standpoint to cover this. And so I think that the chances of getting a code and all that are quite good, but it's going to take some time to get there. And in the meantime, we're going to do this for free to get it figured out. And then once we do, then once we get a little further along, then hopefully it gets covered. Yeah. So
it sounds like I've been on the psych unit, and there was a woman there who was going through ECT, and she had had it 5 years earlier.
Yeah,
now she was going through it again. So I'm wondering if this ITBS, you said it only lasted for 2 weeks, one person. So it sounds very variable from person to person how mm-hmm. long the effect lasts.
Yeah.
So if you have to do it more than one time,
yes.
then
I
see cost problems also.
Yeah.
Like
oh, absolutely. You're
also, right. if you have to go in through a hospital admission, so
uh-huh.
in my case, I was in and out 6 times in 1 year. So how...
Yeah, I agree with everything that you just said. So the people that it lasted 2 weeks for are the extreme ends of depression, right? I think I said this earlier. I had to call around to find them. I did that because it's believable. So when you want to publish something, like we just did, we want to say to the world, hey, we just did something really dramatic. We just did something that wasn't conceived of as being able to be done before. And I need to treat somebody, a group of people, effectively that failed ECT with non-brain surgery. That tells, in my mind, the greater kind of research community, there's a signal, right? And so I went out of my way to find people that are at the extreme ends of this spectrum. But those people are at the extreme ends. Like I said, I couldn't even find them in psychiatry department at Stanford because they didn't have 6 of these people at that severity level, right? And so the majority of people that we've treated that aren't that, it's months and months and months, right? Average of 3, 4, 5, 6 months for people. And so I would say that group of people that I'm describing is less than 1 to 2% of the total depressed population, right? So if you look at the entire population of depressed patients, it's 1 to 2%. And you're right, it's actually not cost effective to treat them, which is why in this graph I said unsustained remission, cortical implant. So we would actually do brain surgery to put something in that would keep doing that. And that is actually sustainable because it's an implant that in the bill code and all that, which is another thing that I do. And so, but that's exceedingly small amount of people. The majority of people that we've treated that have had a response, they're out for a long time. So the majority of people coming onto an inpatient unit, they're not gonna fall into that bucket. And so we think that we'll get 4 months out of this without any other intervention. When I went to the ECT coordinator for Stanford, I said, how many people do you have that are ECT failures? She only find really one for me, which I was so surprised about. I was like, you can't find, you're the ECT coordinator. You've been doing ECT here for 10 years. There's got to be more of these people that you have in your list, and she couldn't find anybody. And so my thoughts here are that I don't actually think it's going to be a problem from access. I think it's just more of me trying to show this as an extreme example and then going and doing more middle of the road people, and that's what we've continuously seen. And so I think from a billing standpoint, if the majority of people get this amount of help for this long of a period of time, like what we're seeing now, that it'll be reimbursed pretty readily.
Actually, I think we have one more question because we're
home. So my question is the efficacy for accelerated the same as regular? And the second question is, do you have any sense of who this doesn't work for? Like, can you do like a brain map and determine ahead of time? Like,
yeah, that's
you said it's like 50%, so is there any sense of who it doesn't work for?
Sure. The normal TMS is about 50%. What we've got is most people. So we've had really 2 to 3 people that failed this, and everybody else in the open label 16-ish people that we've treated have responded or remitted. Right? So it's a majority of the people who treat, which is incredibly surprising to me because a lot of this stuff you asked me 8 months ago was in the half. That's not what we're going to see. That's too high. The only populations of people that I've continuously seen for this target, what I think is not the method, but this target probably doesn't work for people with comorbid OCD. And I think that my sense of the pattern of people that haven't responded yet all seem to have an obsessive problem. They have a body dysmorphic disorder-like problem, or they have like an OCD-like problem. And so, the suggestion there is, in those people, you probably need a new brain target, which may be derived from a map like what you're describing, a scan. It may be derived, at first, at least from just sequential treatments, you treat with A, it doesn't work. In this case, in this algorithm, say non-response, switch to a new target. Switch to a new target and try. The problem with these brain scans is that we don't have a super reliable brain scan to say this is depression, this is schizophrenia, this is that. And so it's not reliable enough to tell us that quite yet. There's some work out of Connor Liston's lab, other folks, we're getting a lot closer to that, but right now nobody can say this person needs this. And so I think this stuff will actually help us with that because we can sequentially try it, get the brain scan, see, okay, these people respond to this target, these people respond to this target, this is the difference between these folks' brains, and then make a decision. And so work like this, I think, gets us closer to that, but it doesn't answer that question for some time.
Well, thank you so much, Dr. More questions,
yeah. Huh? Okay, what are you doing?
Yes, I mean, all of these people, such a rapid audience.
Yeah.
I mean, this is,
yeah.
For the blinded trial, we're limited to mutual. What you want to do in a situation like this is you want to get a specific population group, and then you get the out there and then expand out. Yeah. I'm saying yes to the integration, no to the outpatient. So if whoever this is the person planning on the inpatient unit, would treat them. That's a good question right now. It's not started yet, so we're about 2 months away from starting, and I actually have meetings next week.
It's hard. There's not many beds on the floor. Like, I've been in the emergency room for them, and they've sent me a few
months.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a...
It's got to be out on the table. Yeah.
Oh, no.
And I have some flyers.
Can
I give you guys all the flyers?
You have some flyers?
Yeah. Not necessarily. I mean, it's an issue of just us sitting down and
Does he have any flyers?
Yes. Yeah, he's going to give them out.